So thank you, Jules, for really laying, giving that presentation, because I think this transitions very nicely into this one. And so my presentation today is specifically around the tensions and the power dynamics between what we think of as science or Western science versus indigenous and local knowledge systems. And so throughout this presentation, I would really like for people to think about, how do I define science or information or knowledge? How does my organization define science and information and knowledge? I begin thinking about that. So, I really come from this. I'm the climate adaptation specialist for the Makah tribe, and so I work a lot in this world of climate change adaptation, mitigation, resiliency, and climate science. And so over the past, especially the past year and a half, we have gotten a lot of really dire reports from the IPCC, the report on biodiversity from IPBES, the fourth National Climate Assessment, and the second state of the carbon cycle report. And so, I had the privilege and the honor to be one of the authors for the fourth National Climate Assessment, and this really began to really illuminate what are some of the institutional power structures that prevent kind of the considerations and the tensions around Western science versus indigenous and local knowledge systems. And so, in this slide, a lot of the work that Makah has been doing over the past few years is, how do we really capture our cultural knowledge, how do we capture our traditional knowledge into and throughout the climate resilience planning process, from impacts assessment through adaptation planning through implementation. And so here's one definition of what does indigenous knowledge mean. Local and indigenous knowledge refers to the understanding, skills, and philosophies developed by societies with long histories of interaction with their natural surroundings. For rural and indigenous peoples, local knowledge informs decision-making about fundamental aspects of day-to-day life. And so, not often do I like to show two different definitions, but I think each of these definitions captures a different part of at least how Makah interprets what is indigenous knowledge or traditional knowledge means for them. And so this other one comes from Pierce et al. 2015. In submissions, traditional knowledge or traditional ecological knowledge is built on personal experience and interaction with peers, including people from other communities, and passed on through stories, apprenticeships, and practice. It can be understood as knowledge and skills that are fluid, dynamic, flexible, adaptable, and continually updated and revised in light of new observations and experiences, and it can incorporate new technologies alongside the traditional. And I know this really resonated with not just myself, many other Makah staff, Makah leadership, Makah tribal members, because I think oftentimes when people think about traditional knowledge, indigenous knowledge, tribal customs and traditions, they like to think that these things are static. They froze when European colonization happened in the United States. And it doesn't really give them that honor and the truth that these are cultures and knowledge systems that are dynamic, and that they change as people change, as we understand things differently. And so the dynamic nature of things not being frozen in time really spoke to us with this definition. And so, kind of bridging like indigenous knowledge and then I guess climate science reports. In working on climate assessments with many climate scientists, there were just a lot of different types of limitations, of intentions around how do we actually complement, work, bring both different types of knowledge systems in to inform what we know about climate science and climate impacts. And so here are just some high-level limitations that both myself and many other people who have worked in this space have reflected upon. So again, I'm presenting, but this is really work built on many, many people's energy, labor, time, and shoulders. The first one is really the mismatched validation norms between Western science and Indigenous and local knowledge systems. One of the things that I often hear from climate scientists is, oh, is your Indigenous knowledge peer-reviewed? And I have colleagues and mentors say Indigenous knowledge probably is even better than peer-reviewed because we have generations and generations and thousands of years of community review. And so this really hits on some of the ethical tensions around, do we need to hold Indigenous and local knowledges to the same standards that we hold Western science to, the ideas of peer review and replicability. The second one is transmission or communication of Indigenous knowledges as well. Again, one thing that I constantly hear is when we want to bring this in, not just myself, but many other people, the question is framed of which report is this published in? Where is it? Where can I find this in the literature? And this doesn't really acknowledge that a lot of Indigenous and local knowledges are transmitted through stories, through observations, through customs and traditions, and they are transmitted through journal reports or journal articles. The next one is the decontextualization of Indigenous and local knowledges across spatial, across histories, and geographic scales. Oftentimes, when we think about bringing Indigenous knowledge systems into climate reports, regional climate assessments, national climate assessments, international assessments, it ignores the fact that a lot of Indigenous knowledge is place-based and is developed in conjunction with place. And so what does it mean when we bring that out of that context? There are a lot of ethical implications around that. There are a lot of how do we treat this? What is the meaning of this? Are we severing it from the history, from the people, from the group? And is that even a right thing to do? One of the other things is the ethics of language and intellectual property rights. Oftentimes, when we talk about Indigenous knowledge, we don't talk about it as a robust knowledge system and epistemology. It's often talked about as, oh, these are just tales or myths or legends, and so really our wisdom. And so it's trying to challenge some of these norms that doesn't try to diminish the value and the importance of what Indigenous knowledge can bring to climate science. There's also issues of intellectual property rights. Who does this belong to? Who within the community it belongs to? Which tribal group, cultural group does it belong to? And so again, when we talk about free, prior, and informed consent, a lot of that is based in protecting cultural and culturally sensitive and confidential information for communities and within the community as well. And the last one is issues of ethics of process engagement. Oftentimes, what really keeps many of my colleagues is when scientists think they've discovered Indigenous knowledge and they can now incorporate it into their work. And this type of mind frame, it reinforces historical dynamics between Western scientists, white settlers, and with Indigenous peoples and knowledge holders. And so how do we begin reshaping and reframing relationships around what we consider science, what we consider knowledge, and how do we engage to facilitate this conversation? So how do we restructure power dynamics and how we interpret the word science or scientific epistemologies. And so in the environmental space, we cannot separate our work with historical legacies and trauma between Western scientists and Indigenous peoples and knowledge holders. We really need a systemic reframing of our values and treatment of these diversity of knowledge systems. And I say diversity because, again, Indigenous knowledge systems, I always say plural because the Makah knowledge system will be different than another Indigenous group's knowledge system. And finally, the development of robust and ethical protocols of engagement and treatment of Indigenous knowledge is extremely critical if we're going to approach this